Jessica Lange and Ed Harris star in Sweet Dreams, the troubled love story behind the career of country singer Patsy Cline. One of four new movies we'll be reviewing this week on At the Movies, the movie review program. I'm Gene Siskel, film critic of the Chicago Tribune.
And I'm Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times. In addition to Sweet Dreams, this week we'll also be reviewing Marie with Sissy Spacek as a woman who rises to the top of Tennessee state politics and exposes the corruption she finds there. And we'll look at Invasion USA with Chuck Norris as a one-man army fighting a mysterious band of violent invaders. First, Gene starts with a complicated whodunit named Jagged Edge.
Jagged Edge is both a terrific courtroom drama and a genuinely scary thriller. How scary? Well, I've got a whole new movie critics test, I think, for a scary movie. Roger, I call it the backseat test. It works this way. Do you, after leaving the theater and getting in your car, look in the back seat just to make sure no one is hiding back there ready to stab you? Jagged Edge, I'm embarrassed to admit, made me do that. But I liked it. I knew it. It really worked on me. It's a murder story with Jeff Bridges accused of murdering his rich wife and a Charles Manson-like stabbing to gain control, it's alleged, of her money and power. Bridges, of course, claims he's innocent, but an assistant district attorney discovers the money motive, and he excitedly tells his boss.
Everything was in her name. The corporate stuff, the personal stuff, everything. I mean, she owned the guy. He was an employee, and you know what? He gets it all. Jack Forster is the direct beneficiary of all of Paige Forster's corporate and personal assets.
You really think he could have done that to his own wife?
What the hell is that, Al? You murder your wife to take all the money? That is the oldest crime in the world. Only you're real smart. You want people to say, Jesus, you think he could have done that to his own wife? If I was going to kill my wife, that's the way I'd do it.
That district attorney, Peter Coyote from E.T., has a grudge against Bridges, so Bridges hires one of his former assistants, a trial lawyer played by Glenn Close.
I'm not going to lie to you.
Okay. I want Sam to have access to all your personal and corporate correspondence, your financial records, your wife's records, everything, absolute access.
You've got it.
We've got almost 4 months till the trial. I don't want you out in public. I don't want to see any pictures of you in the paper. I want you to look as though your life has been shattered.
My life has been shattered.
Part of the legal battle is over a hunting knife with a jagged edge supposedly found in Bridges' locker, and Glenn Close proves to be a good attorney for the defense.
Mr. Fabrizi, does this look like the knife that you saw that day?
No. This one's different.
How is it different?
Well, it's the same kind of knife, all right, but no, this one here is all scratched up in the sides and the handle's all worn.
Mr. Fabrizi, if this knife was brand new and hadn't been used for over a year and a half, would it look like the knife you saw? Could it have been the knife you saw, Mr. Fabrizi? Is it possible, Mr. Fabrizi?
I don't know. Yes, it's just possible.
Your Honor, I would like this knife marked and admitted into evidence as defense exhibit B.
I love courtroom dramas, going back to Inherit the Wind and Anatomy of Murder, two of my favorites. Sometimes this is almost that good. Now, none of that gives you, though, the level of tension this film develops. Not only as we sit there in judgment of Jeff Bridges, right from the very beginning of the movie all the way through to the end, but also as we see Glenn Close's life placed in peril. There are more twists and turns here than in most any two thrillers you can name, except for the great ones directed by Alfred Hitchcock. And here's another admission I hate to make, but it's a compliment to the movie. I even guessed wrong on the ending of this picture. So a big thumbs up for me on Jagged Edge. It fooled me. It scared me.
It scared me, too. I enjoyed it. Three good performances. Peter Coyote, I think, is an underrated actor. He's getting a lot of attention these days. Glenn Close, terrific. And so soon after Maxie, which was so bad. And, of course, a terrific performance again by Jeff Bridges, who was another underrated actor.
Jeff Bridges hasn't given a bad performance. I once tried an interview with him. I once tracked back all of his films. He's been in one great film after another.
Very dependable, very interesting. Right. And the director here, Richard Marquand, his credits include Eye of the Needle. So this is a real good package in that way, and it worked. But I have one hypothesis I want to try out on you, and wouldn't dare give away the ending.
Don't you.
But I will say that at the end, we do find out who did it. As you admitted, you were fooled. I think that given the fact that this whole movie is based upon making us go first
I know
one way
say.
And then the other,
I know.
First we think somebody did it, then we think somebody else did it, then we think somebody else is framed. At the end,
we should not
the
have
last
known.
Shot, we shouldn't have known.
Okay.
Everybody should be walking out of the theater saying who they think did it, because you and I would have had an argument then, because I thought that it was the guy that you didn't think it was.
Okay. Now, here's what's interesting. I think that would have been a better ending, too, and I think Glenn Close sometimes is not strong enough as a woman professional should be in the film. But I like the fact that it was cast with a woman lawyer. I like the fact that you could see some black people in the cast finally. We haven't seen that in the movies in a long time. There is so much good about this film. You have a little better ending. It's still a terrific one.
Okay, I more or less agree. I'm glad that they had a woman lawyer, too, because it would have been a much different movie if Jeff Bridges had fallen in love with his male defense attorney. Next is the movie, Sissy Spacek as the woman who helped reform the Tennessee prison system.
Do you intend to fire me, Governor?
Maybe. It's up to you.
Our next movie is named Marie, and it stars Sissy Spacek in another one of those roles she's becoming famous for as an ordinary woman who fights for what she believes in no matter what it costs her. Her character this time is based on the true story of Marie Rejanti, a divorcee who starts out to support herself and her chronically ill son, and who works her way to the top of the Tennessee state political system. Along the way, she catches the eye of a top assistant to the governor, a man who has the clout to get her a really good-paying job with the state parole board. But in this scene, he explained that the job comes with a few strings attached.
A position opens up on the parole board in 2 months, and the governor wants a Democrat in that post. And he also thinks it should go to a woman. But it has to be a woman who is familiar with things like clemency proceedings and paroles and DAs.
Betty, are you kidding?
All it requires is the governor's signature.
Me on the parole board.
Marie, it's one of the best paid jobs in state government. Knowing your situation, we figured it might help. From our side, we want somebody in there we can count on to be loyal to the governor.
That's Jeff Daniels from Terms of Endearment as a slick politician named Eddie Sisk. Before long, Spacek hears disturbing rumors the paroles are for sale in the state of Tennessee, and when she tells Sisk, he doesn't want to know.
Eddie, I've got to talk to you.
Okay, fire.
I just talked to Gary Gerbitz, and he said that Bill Thompson and Tommy Prater are like that.
You talked to Gerbitz about Prater?
Yes. Eddie, give me some credit. He doesn't suspect anything, but I think we should.
Nothing's happened. No money has changed hands.
Eddie, Tommy Prater and Bill Thompson are friends.
You better hope this doesn't get out, Marie, because if it does, you're through. I got you this appointment. You better remember that.
We're only talking about...
What she knows could cause a major political scandal in the state, and so she's threatened with being fired and having charges brought against her. It doesn't take her long to figure out she needs a lawyer.
Now, these are your own records. They kill you. And God only knows what they've got. There's only one way to win a lawsuit like this, and that's to put them on trial. Now, you're going to have to prove that you weren't fired because you didn't do your job. You were fired because you did.
Well, somebody has to stand up to them, Fred.
And if you lose the case, people are going to think everything the governor said about you is true.
Well, everybody thinks that already.
Well, I guess you got yourself a lawyer.
And that lawyer there is played by Fred Thompson, who is famous from the Watergate case. Right. And also in real life was Marie Rejanti's lawyer. And the whole movie, Marie, sticks close to real life. It was shot on location in Tennessee. It was based on the trial and testimony that sent top officials to jail in real life. And Sissy Spacek has apparently done her homework in getting us inside the skin of this ordinary woman with extraordinary courage. The performance reminded me of the other great Spacek roles, like Coal Miner's Daughter and Missing, where she takes the materials of everyday life and transforms them. This is a good movie.
I think she's a good performer, a terrific actress. Actually, I don't think the movie is that good. Let me tell you why. It's just what you said in the beginning, but I take it the other way. And that is a role that she's becoming familiar with, and that is the ordinary woman who fights against the odds and does victory. Mm-hmm. She isn't the only one. We've got a lot of actresses right now who are doing it. It all started with Sally Field and Norma Rae. And Sally Field does it, and then we all know all the Save the Fire movies and all that sort of thing. I'm getting tired of seeing a lot of our best actresses play these noble women. What that does for me while I'm seeing the story is, gee, goodness is going to triumph over evil. And I'm
I've seen that a lot. She isn't even really that noble. I think you're being very unfair to this character and to this performance. She starts out as a woman who's trying to keep her family together, and especially this son who's ill. and pay the rent and hold things together. She gets in at a low rung of state politics.
Right.
And when she gets to the top, one of the fascinating things about this movie is she wants to play along to the degree that she can. It's just that eventually she finds that things are so corrupt that she is forced to take this stand. She is not some Florence Nightingale here. She is a real woman in the real world.
Roger, I swear to you, from the moment this thing began, I knew just the way it was going to go.
Well, you knew that because they wouldn't have made the movie if it hadn't gone
that
way.
Okay, but I want to give
the struggle she went through is interesting.
And I want to give you another movie that went just the other way. Silkwood. Meryl Streep. You know that Meryl Streep is going to die. Of course, that's based on a real case, too. But there was a lot of intrigue in that film, Silkwood, which was a much better film about an ordinary woman fighting because you couldn't
I'll give you that Silkwood is a better film than this film. But nevertheless, I thought Marie was really interesting because of all the details of stateroom politics and the Jeff Bridges character,
Jeff Daniels' character.
Reminded me so much of people like that in politics when I used to cover them,
I just repeat.
The courtroom fixer, I like that.
Okay, better. And he's a supporting character, and the movie isn't called Jeff Daniels, it's called Marie. Coming up next at the movies, she was a singing friend of a coal miner's daughter. Now we get to see her story.
You want a lot, don't you?
Yeah, I do, baby.
Well, people in hell want ice water. That don't mean.
Our next film, Sweet Dreams, tells of the highs and lows and tragic ending to the life of country singing star Patsy Cline, who died at the age of 30 in a 1963 plane crash. Jessica Lange stars as Patsy Cline, who was famous for such classic full-throated ballads as Crazy and I Fall to Pieces. Before the film gets to those musical numbers, it concentrates on Patsy Cline's love life. First, she's trapped in a bad marriage. Then one night, a savior appears, played by Ed Harris.
At the high school, you said you wanted to buy me a drink.
I want a 77.
Just 77.
Well, you got the advantage on me. You know my name, but I don't know yours.
Charlie. Charlie Dick.
Dick? Oh, Charlie Dick?
That's right.
Well, so what do you want out of me, Charlie? I mean, I figure you didn't follow me out to Rainbow Road because you're a fool for music.
Hell no. I want to get to know you better.
They do fall in love, but the marriage is rocky. More smooth is her singing career, which takes off after she meets a savvy record producer.
I'm Randy Hughes.
Hey, I was just coming to see you.
Is that right?
Yeah. You know, you wrote me a letter about a year ago or so, but I had a baby since then. I haven't been doing too much singing, but
I... You don't have to sell me. I happen to think you're maybe the best country singer in the world. Come in here. That's you and I talking.
I always did like a man who knew how to start off a conversation good.
I swear, I can make us both a lot of money. You won't be sorry. You know why not?
Why?
Because when the song is right and I feel it, I can tell from looking at people's faces that I've reached right down there inside them. You got any idea what that feels like?
You want to be Kitty Wells, right?
Hell no! I want to be Hank Williams.
That's a good line. Sweet Dreams was a disappointment for me, though, because of how superficial it is. It seemed more like a made-for-TV movie that just hurtles along, just skimming the emotional surface of events. Her songs, her husband's drinking, their romantic good times together, a couple of songs, then whammo, the plane crash. I just happen to have a couple of Patsy Cline songs at home in my jukebox, so I'm really a fan of hers, but I didn't learn that much more about her than anyone could find out in a paragraph or two in some biography of country singing stars. And when you compare this film with the Loretta Lynn story, Coal Miner's Daughter, the standard for this kind of biography, I'm afraid that Sweet Dreams really comes up short.
This one does come up short. It was produced by the same people, too.
Yes.
They had the stories of both people under contract.
Yes.
And first, they had Sissy Spacek as Loretta Lynn. Now they have Jessica Lange as Patsy Cline.
Right.
The funny thing is this competition is going on in a way because last year, I think Jessica Lange won last year's competition and her country was better than Sissy Spacek's The River. So she won last year. This year, I think Sissy Spacek still comes out in front. This movie is very one-dimensional. I question the fact that they didn't have Jessica Lange sing the song. Maybe she can't sing. Sissy Spacek did a great job of singing in Coal Miner's Daughter. In many ways, this movie is just another step or two down the whole rung of ambition from Coal Miner's Daughter.
Well, in Coal Miner's Daughter, if you think about it, we had those great early scenes back in the, you know, in the South, where we don't get to see enough of that kind of South. Then we saw the full arc of the career where she becomes a great star and then has trouble. This film, given the life that they're dealing with, it starts, she's already a pretty good singer in clubs, and then goes up, and then unfortunately it ends. Mm-hmm. So I don't think that the material itself probably could have been as great a movie.
Her life, you're saying, didn't give them the raw material to make a good
movie. But also, they didn't, I won't let them out that easy. They didn't make it a good enough film.
Next of the movies, Chuck Norris gets behind the wheel of his big pickup truck and goes out to fight Invasion USA. Roma, the educated skunk, is still on vacation, so he couldn't be here to help us. Where does the skunk go on vacation?
Drive-ins. They hibernate.
They hibernate for the
popcorn
winter, waiting for the big spring pictures to open. So it's kind of amazing, though, that we would have wanted Roma here to help get on Chuck Norris's case only a few months after Chuck Norris made a really good action picture named Code of Silence, which we both like. Mm-hmm. That movie had a lot of good characters, an interesting plot, great stunts, and a real sense of style. And those qualities are all lacking in Invasion USA, which does, however, contain the most idiotic supporting character in any movie this year. And I think that's not even a close call. And it also contains one of the worst musical scores I've ever heard. One of those potted pseudo-symphonic, you know, boom, 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 boom. While these guys are driving through the streets, a bunch of terrorists, they are, who invade South Florida and start blowing up such American symbols as church services, school buses, and shopping malls. Boom, 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 boom. They'll stop at nothing. They even fire their bazookas at happy suburbanites who are decorating their Christmas trees. Deck the halls with boughs of holly. Boom, 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 boom. American law enforcement officials are, of course, helpless in the face of these invaders. For one thing, Gene, I guess they couldn't see them in the streets with their camouflage uniforms on, holding their bazookas as they drive along in their rent-a-cars.
Right.
So the army calls out Chuck Norris. It turns into a one-man army in his pickup truck. Probably the worst single thing in the movie is that horrible supporting performance by an angry newspaper reporter and photographer played by Melissa Prophet. Her only function in this movie is to be an angry woman who shoots photos at random, and I mean at random.
Right. Right.
And then she makes bitter, cynical remarks to Chuck Norris. For example, at one point he saves her life, and she brushes him off with, "Thanks a lot, cowboy." Chuck Norris is going to disappoint a lot of fans with Invasion USA.
I think you've taken care of the movie fairly well. It's stunningly bad. The other thing is, there's one big logical flaw. Now, the guy that's doing the invading is a Russian. I mean, he's got a Russian name. And
Ruskov, I think.
Russian. Now, you don't work alone in Russia, you know? I mean, the government tells you what to do there, right?
You probably wouldn't invade also with Cubans and Orientals on your strike force.
Well, maybe you would, because Red Dawn used a little bit of that, too.
Okay.
But my point is that I don't think that Russia is going to do just this kind of invasion in a limited kind of way and then call it off. And then when Chuck Norris stops, that's it. I mean, I think that they would might go in a little bigger way and have a second thing.
Yeah, if I were a Russian general, I would say Chuck Norris is starting our troops in Florida, so let's drop a hydrogen bomb on Florida, and that will probably stop Chuck Norris.
It also would have made it a much shorter film and a much better film. Now let's review our reactions to the movies on this show. Both Roger and I were really impressed with the courtroom drama, Jagged Edge. It felt good to be scared again after a comedy summer. Two thumbs up for that film. A split decision on Marie, the Sissy Spacek drama. Roger bought the whole thing. I stack it up against similar women against the system films like Silkwood, and Marie, for me, comes across like a soap opera. We're back in agreement. Two thumbs down for Sweet Dreams, the superficial story of country singer Patsy Cline. And if you haven't figured it out by now, we both hated Chuck Norris in Invasion USA, even worse than his two missing in action films.
That's putting it mildly. That's it for this week. Next week at the movies, Arnold Schwarzenegger, fresh from the Terminator, is back as Commando. And in the Journey of Natty Gann, we'll see a 1930s drama about a young girl's cross-country search for her father. And until then, we'll see you at the movies. Dun, 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 dun.